Once again, welcome to the parish for our Good Friday service. I invite you to please rise. Our service can be found on the screen today, or if you would like to follow along in the prayer book, we are in the green book of alternative services, beginning on page 308 today. And now begin us with the ministry of the word. All we like sheep have gone astray, we have turned everyone to his own way. Christ the Lord became obedient unto death.
Even death on the cross.
Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we have sinned in thought and word and deed. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We pray you of your mercy. Forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve you in newness of life, to the glory of your name. Amen. And as we remain standing, I share with you our collect for this Good Friday. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Almighty God, look graciously, we pray, on this your family, for whom our Lord Jesus Christ was willing to be betrayed and given into the hands of sinners and to suffer death upon the cross, who now lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. Amen. I invite you to please be seated for our readings.
This reading is taken from the book of Isaiah. The Lord says, my servant will succeed in his task. He will be highly honored, and so I will give him a place of honor, a place among great and powerful men. He willingly gave his life and shared the fate of evil men. He took the place of many sinners and prayed that they might be forgiven. The words of the Lord. And please join me in the refrain of the psalm. My God, why have you forsaken me? My God, why have you forsaken me? And are so far from my cry and from the words of my distress. Oh my God, I cry in the daytime, but you do not answer, by night as well, but I find no rest. Yet, you are the only one enthroned upon the praises of Israel. Our forefathers put their trust in you. They trusted, and you delivered them.
My God,
have you forsaken me? They cried out to you and were delivered. They trusted in you and were not put to shame. But as for me, I am a worm and no man, scorned by all and despised by the people. Why have you forsaken me? All who see me laugh me to scorn. They curl their lips and wag their heads, saying, he trusted in the Lord. Let him deliver him. Let him rescue him if he delights in him. Why have you forsaken me? Yet you are he who took me out of the womb and kept me safe upon my mother's breast. I have been entrusted to you ever since I was born. You are my God when I was still in my mother's womb.
My God,
have you forsaken? Be not far from me, for trouble is near, and there is none to help. Many young bulls encircle me. Strong bulls of Bashan surround me. They open wide their jaws at me like a ravening and a rearing lion. Why are you forsaking me? I am poured out like water. All my bones are out of joint. My heart within my breast is melting wax. My mouth is dried out like a pot shed. My tongue sticks to the roof of my mouth. And you have laid me in the dust of the grave. Packs of dogs close me in, and gangs of evildoers circle around me. They pierce my hand and my feet. I can count all my bones. They stare and gloat over me. They divide my garments among them. They cast lost for my clothing. My God, are you forsaking me? Be not far away, O Lord. You are my strength. Ask him to help me. Save me from the sword, my life from the power of the dog. Save me from the lion's mouth, my wretched body from the horns of wild bulls. I will declare your name to my brethren. In the midst of the congregation, I will praise you. Why have you forsaken me? Praise the Lord. You that fear him, stand in awe of him. O offspring of Israel, all of you Jacob's line, give glory. For he does not despise nor abhor the poor in their poverty, neither does he hide his face from them. But when they cry to him, he hears them. My God. Have you forsaken me? My praise is of him in the great assembly. I will perform my vows in the presence of those who worship him. The poor shall eat and be satisfied, and those who seek the Lord shall praise him. My God. Why have you forsaken me? May your heart live forever. My God, why have you forsaken me? All the ends of the heart shall remember and turn to the Lord, and all the families of the nations shall bow before him. For kingship belongs to the Lord. He rules over the nations. To him alone, all who sleep in the heart bow down in worship. All who go down to the dust fall before him. My God, have you forsaken? My soul shall live for him. My descendants shall serve him. They shall be known as the Lord's forever. They shall come and make known to a people yet unborn the saving deeds that he has done. My God, why have you forsaken me?
The second reading is from the letter to the Hebrews. Since then, we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God. Let us hold fast to our confession, for we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but we have one who in every respect has been tested as we are, yet without sin. Let us therefore approach the throne of grace with boldness, so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in time of need. In the days of his flesh, Jesus offered up prayers and supplications with loud cries and tears to the one who was able to save him from death. And he was heard because of his reverent submission. Although he was a son, he learned obedience through what he suffered. And having been made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation for all who obey him. The word of the Lord.
The Passion of Our Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus went out with his disciples across the Kindred Valley to a place where there was a garden, which he and his disciples entered. Now Judas, who betrayed him, also knew the place because Jesus often met there with his disciples. So Judas brought a detachment of soldiers together with police from the chief priest and the Pharisees, and they came there with lanterns and torches and weapons. Then Jesus, knowing all that was to happen to him, came forward and asked them,
"Whom are you looking for?"
They answered,
"Jesus."
Jesus replied,
"I am he."
Judas, who betrayed him, was standing with them. When Jesus said to them, "I am he," they stepped back and fell to the ground. Again, he asked them,
"Whom are you looking for?"
And they said,
"Jesus of Nazareth."
Jesus answered,
"I told you that I am he. So if you are looking for me, let these men go."
This was to fulfill the word that he had spoken,
"I did not lose a single one of those whom you gave me."
Then Simon Peter, who had a sword, drew it, struck the high priest's slave, and cut off his right ear. The slave name was Malchus. Jesus said to Peter,
"Put your sword back into its sheath. Am I not to drink the cup that the Father has given me?"
So the soldiers, their officer, and the Jewish police arrested Jesus and bound him. First, they took him to Annas, who was the father-in-law of Caiaphas, the high priest that year. Caiaphas was the one who had advised the Jews that it was better to have one person die for the people. Simon Peter and another disciple followed Jesus. Since that disciple was known to the high priest, he went with Jesus into the courtyard of the high priest. But Peter was standing outside at the gate. So the other disciple, who was known to the high priest, went out, spoke to the woman who guarded the gate, and brought Peter in. The woman said to Peter, "He said,
I am not."
Now the slaves and the police had made a charcoal fire because it was cold, and they were standing around it and warming themselves. Peter also was standing with them and warming himself. Then the high priest questioned Jesus about his disciples and about his teaching. Jesus answered,
"I have spoken openly to the world. I have always taught in synagogues and in the temple, where all the Jews come together. I have said nothing in secret. Why do you ask me? Ask those who heard what I said to them. They know what I said."
When he had said this, one of the police standing nearby struck Jesus on the face, saying,
"Is that how you answer the high priest?"
Jesus answered,
"If I have spoken wrongly, testify to the wrong. But if I have spoken rightly, why do you strike me?"
Then Annas sent him bound to Caiaphas, the high priest. Now Simon Peter was standing and warming himself. They asked him, He denied it and said,
"I am not."
One of the slaves of the high priest, a relative of the man whose ear Peter had cut off, asked,
"Did I not see you in the garden with
him?" Again, Peter denied it, and at that moment the cock crowed. Then they took Jesus from Caiaphas to the Pilate's headquarters. It was early in the morning. They themselves did not enter the headquarters so as to avoid ritual defilement and to be able to eat the Passover. So Pilate went out to them and said,
"What accusation do you bring against this man?"
They answered,
"If this man were not a criminal, he would not have handed him over to you."
Pilate said to them,
"Take yourself and judge him according to your law."
The Jews replied, This was to fulfill what Jesus had said when he indicated the kind of death he was to die. Then Pilate entered the headquarters again, summoned Jesus, and asked him, Jesus answered,
Do you ask this on your own, or did others tell you about me?
Pilate replied, Jesus answered,
My kingdom is not from this world. If my kingdom were from this world, my followers would be fighting to keep me from being handed over to the Jews. But as it is, my kingdom is not from here.
Pilate asked him, Jesus answered,
You say that I am a king. For this I was born, and for this I came into the world, to testify to the truth. Everyone who belongs to the truth listens to my voice.
Pilate asked him, After he had said this, he went out to the Jews again and told them, They shouted in reply,
Not this man, but Barabbas.
Now Barabbas was a bandit. Then Pilate took Jesus and had him flogged. And the soldiers wove a crown of thorns and put it on his head. And they dressed him in a purple robe. They kept coming up to him, saying, And striking him on the face, Pilate went out again and said to them, So Jesus came out, wearing the crown of thorns and the purple robe. Pilate said to them, When the chief priest and the police saw him, they shouted,
Crucify him! Crucify him!
Pilate said to them, The Jews answered him, Now when Pilate heard this, he was more afraid than ever. He entered his headquarters again and asked Jesus. But Jesus gave him no answer. Pilate therefore said to him, Jesus answered him,
You would have no power over me unless it had been given you from above. Therefore, the one who handed me over to you is guilty of a greater sin.
From then on, Pilate tried to release him, but the Jews cried out,
If you release
When Pilate heard these words, he brought Jesus outside and sat on the judge's bench at a place called the Stone Pavement, or in Hebrew, Gabbatha. Now it was the day of preparation for the Passover, and it was about noon. He said to the Jews, They cried out,
Away with him! Away with him! Crucify him!
Pilate asked them. The chief priest answered, Then he handed him over to them to be crucified. So they took Jesus, and carrying the cross by himself, he went out to what is called the place of the skull, which in Hebrew is called Golgotha. They there crucified him, and with two others, one on either side, with Jesus between them. Pilate also had an inscription written and put on the cross. It read, Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews. Many of the Jews read this inscription because the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city, and it was written in Hebrew, in Latin, and in Greek. Then the chief priests of the Jews said to Pilate, Pilate answered, When the soldiers had crucified Jesus, They took his clothes and divided them into four parts, one for each soldier. They also took his tunic. Now the tunic was seamless, woven in one piece from the top. So they said to one another, "This was to fulfill what the scripture says. They divided my clothes among themselves, and for my clothing they cast lots." And that is what the soldiers did. Meanwhile, standing near the cross of Jesus were his mother and his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus saw his mother and the disciples whom he loved standing beside her, he said to his mother,
"Woman, here is your son."
Then he said to the disciple,
"Here is your mother."
And from the hour, from that hour, the disciples took her into his own home. After this, when Jesus knew that all was finished, he said, in order to fulfill the scripture,
"I am thirsty."
A jar full of sour wine was standing there. So they put a sponge full of wine on a branch of hyssop and held it to his mouth. When Jesus had received the wine, he said,
"It is finished."
Then he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. Since it was the day of preparation, the Jews did not want the bodies left on the cross during the Sabbath, especially because that Sabbath was a day of great solemnity. So they asked Pilate to have the legs of the crucified men broken and the bodies removed. Then the soldiers came and broke the legs of the first and of the other who had been crucified with him. But when they came to Jesus and saw that he was already dead, they did not break his legs. Instead, one of the soldiers pierced his side with a spear, and at once blood and water came out. He who saw this has testified so that you also may believe. His testimony is true, and he knows that he tells the truth. These things occurred so that the scripture might be fulfilled. None of his bones shall be broken. And again, another passage of scripture says, "They will look on the one whom they have pierced." After these things, Joseph of Arimathea, who was a disciple of Jesus, though a secret one because of his fear of the Jews, asked Pilate to let him take away the body of Jesus. Pilate gave him permission, so he came and removed his body. Nicodemus, who had at first come to Jesus by night, also came, bringing a mixture of myrrh and aloes, weighing about 100 pounds. They took the body of Jesus and wrapped it with the spices in linen cloths, according to the burial custom of the Jews. Now there was a garden in the place where he was crucified, and in the garden there was a new tomb in which no one had ever been laid. And so, because it was the Jewish day of preparation, and the tomb was nearby, they laid Jesus there.
We now come to the point in our service where we will have reflections on the seven last words of Jesus. You will notice in your leaflet that between each word will be three verses of the hymn, Holy Jesu. For those who are leading the reflections today, I ask that you wait until those verses have finished and then come up for your reading. And please just come up in order. I won't introduce you individually. So again, when the reader before you has finished and those hymn verses are done, make your way up. And with that, for our first word today, I invite Brenda forward.
Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." Luke 23, verse 34. Calvary's cross has been set by God, where his only begotten Son was sent to save us from our sins. You begin to see the path he endured by the religious leaders and the Roman soldiers. The cross on his back, the nails in his hand, the crown of thorns on his head, and yet Jesus had mercy on those that afflicted him. What amazing love. Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Reflecting on this response, we will ask ourselves, how can Jesus say these words? They had to know the pain they were inflicting on him, but they didn't believe in Jesus Christ. They really didn't know who Jesus was. Forgiveness is one of the tests of a Christian character. I'm a recipient of God's forgiveness, and I'm sure that most of you, or all of you, are as well. In life, we experience pain, be it physical, mental, etc., by someone or something. My experience with saying I'm sorry, even though I was not at fault, was the beginning of a new, successful life. The scripture really reveals that you don't have to be wrong to say I'm sorry. Sorry belongs to the one who is wronged. We know once we place our problems to God that he will direct our path. Forgiving someone that deeply hurt us is painful. Asking God's forgiveness is an active role that we must undertake. For example, we have to get out of our warm beds every morning to go to church, to go to work, or to play. And we have that same energy to actively verbalize our prayer to God to grant us his forgiveness, which eventually become part of our daily prayer. Forgiveness doesn't mean the absence of pain, but the absence of bitterness and the beginning of experiencing God's powerful peace, which surpasses all understanding. Therefore, relinquishing control over God, which is an act of faith, trusting God that he can do a better job. In John 15:4, Jesus said, "Abide in me and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit of itself except it abide in the vine, no more can ye except ye abide in me." So abide, remain, and deepen your relationship with God. The strength of our life will depend on how long you remain in God. Ask the Savior to help you, comfort, strengthen, and keep you. He is willing to aid you. He will carry you through. Amen.
He replied, "Truly I tell you, today you will be with me in paradise." Luke 23:43. From bedside conversions to last rites to the debate over a really was the Messiah. But the other criminal is repentant, takes ownership for his misdeeds, and asks Jesus to remember him when Jesus takes up his kingdom. And Jesus says to him, "Truly I tell you, today you will be with me in paradise." Jesus' promise to the good thief, as it's known on the cross, where he says, "Truly I tell you, today you will be with me in paradise," is used as belief that the spirit or the soul of the faithful departed has conscious existence in heaven before the resurrection. Or in other words, when we die, we go straight to heaven to be with God and to be with those departed loved ones that have gone before us. Yet not all are convinced that Jesus really told the repentant criminal they would be together in paradise that very day. You see, some over the centuries and some Christian denominations, even up to today, debated on where to place the comma in this line. The comma, most likely absent from Luke's original manuscript, as in those early centuries of the church, manuscripts were written with little or no punctuation at all. If that comma is placed before the word today, as most translations do, we would have the traditional meaning, "Truly I tell you, today you will be with me in paradise." But if it's placed after today, then Jesus' words would have an entirely different connotation. "Truly I tell you, today you will be with me in paradise." This had led some to believe that it's at the second coming that all of the faithful departed are raised to be with Christ, not at the time of death. So there's some legacy around this and some debates over the centuries from these words from the cross. But I'm not here to talk about those today, just wanted to point those out, because what goes beyond debate goes beyond where this comma should be placed are that these words of Jesus to the thief on the cross has led to comfort and hope for countless people over the centuries, especially those for those who find the Lord towards the end of their lives, those who may be repenting for a life away from God. They rightfully find in Jesus' words to the thief the promise of a second chance, or a 151st chance. They find in these words and the promise of from the cross the loving nature of a God who is always reaching out to us in grace and in mercy, who welcomes those who humbly return to him, right up and maybe even beyond their last breath. The tradition of last rites in the Christian churches sprang from the hope of Christ's promise to welcome the repentant soul into his kingdom, right up to the end. The words of a loving God, "Today you'll be with me in paradise," even in the midst of anguish and pain and crucifixion. The words of a loving God extending love and forgiveness and mercy to the repentant criminal and to those who were doing him harm. It's humbling. It's awe-inspiring. It will be woven through all of the reflections you hear today, woven through all of the hymns and the readings we hear, not only on Good Friday, but through all of Holy Week. The love and mercy and unconditional forgiveness that Jesus gave, even from the cross and at his moment of death, stands at the heart of what we remember today. "Today thou shalt be with me in paradise." Thanks be to God. Amen.
Glory to you. The third word Jesus spoke from the cross, "Woman, behold your son." Then he said to the disciple, "Behold your mother." These were the words spoken by Jesus when he saw his mother and the disciples he loved at the foot of the cross. We could ask ourselves, why did Jesus refer to his mother as woman instead of mother? It was not out of disrespect, but he knew Mary was suffering, and addressing her as mother would be devastating for a mother already stricken with grief. The presence of Mary at the cross adds humanity and horror to the scene. We are reminded that Jesus was a real human being, a man who was once a boy carried in the womb of his mother, even as he was dying on the cross as a savior of the world. Jesus also a son, a role he didn't neglect in his last moments. One could only imagine the sorrow Mary felt to see her son mocked, tortured, and crucified. To bear witness to this gruesome austerity must have been unimaginable. Mary seeing Jesus on the cross must have been reminded of the prophecy of Simeon after Jesus' birth, when he said to her, "This child was destined for the fall and rising of many, and a sword will pierce your very soul." Luke chapter 2, verse 35. Despite his pain and suffering, Jesus' concerns are for the ones that love him. The good son that he is, Jesus is concerned about taking care of his mother. He was asking his disciple to take of his mother someone who could comfort, honor, and share his mother's grief. As a loving son, Jesus wants to ensure his earthly mother is cared for after his death. As I reflect on these words, "Woman, behold your son," and then to the disciple, "Behold your mother," it reassures me that we are all daughters, sons, sisters, and brothers in Christ. Jesus spoke of this while teaching in the temple. His mother and brother came to have a word with him, and it was told to him, "Your mother and your brother are seeking you outside." He answered them, saying, "Who is my mother or my brother?" Then looking around again at those who sat about him, he said, "Here is my mother and my brothers. For whoever does the will of my God is my brother, my sister, and my mother." This is a reminder that we are all our brothers and sisters' keeper. Let us pray. O God, how can I begin to thank you for what you suffered? My words fall short. My thoughts seem superficial and vague. Nevertheless, I offer my sincere gratitude for your suffering on the cross for the redemption of my sins. I give you my praise, my heart, and all that I am, because you have given your life for me and the world. Amen.
Jesus said, my God, why have you forsaken me? In the most critical moments of the entire Bible, the moment when Jesus dies on the cross, he shouts from the cross a phrase that can be puzzling to those of us reading the account so many centuries later. It reads, and about the ninth hour, Jesus cried out with a loud voice, saying, Eli, Eli, lema sabachthani? My God, why have you forsaken me? Forsake means to turn away from or withdraw from. Why would God do that to his own son? As it is something that we should not do to our own children, it is hard that the source of all love will turn away from his own son. Yet, this is exactly what has happened in this moment. This sacrifice has to be done by our Lord Jesus because it was necessary for the fulfillment of God's love for humanity to be realized and to tell us how much God values us. Matthew 27:35-34 and Mark 15:29-32 both say that the people mocking Jesus claiming that if God loved him so much, then God should save him in that moment. When Jesus cried out like this, he was also calling out his dependence upon God and his gratitude for the benevolence of God. He recognized the desperation of humanity that suddenly hung upon his shoulders. And even in that agonizing moment, his voice called out to show that only God can deliver us. That was a moment of ultimate pain and loss, as only the burden of his sin could cause. It was a manifestation of God's hatred of sin in some unexplained way that Jesus experienced in that horrible, terrible hour. The suffering he endured was due to us, and it is that suffering by which we can be saved from eternal death. It was at this time that God made him, who had no sin, to bear our cross so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. And Jesus was feeling that weight of sin. He was experiencing a separation from God for the only time in all of all eternity. Jesus utterly depended upon God, even when he could not feel anything but the weight of the sin of the world. This was also a fulfillment of the prophetic statement in Psalm 22:1, verse 1. My God, why have you forsaken me? Why are you so far from saving me from the words of my groaning? We are invited to do the same in our lives, to depend on God, trust in his love, and believe that eternal love is offered to us through the sacrifice of Jesus, his son. Although he was a son, he learned obedience through what he suffered. And having been made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation for all who obeyed him. It leads us to the conclusion that the humiliation of suffering and death of Jesus Christ removed the barriers between us and God. Let us pray. We pray according to Psalm. O God, hide not thy face far from us. Put not us, your children, away in anger. Thou hast been our help. Leave us not, neither forsake us, O God of our salvation. Amen.
Lord, have mercy on me. Hear us, holy. I thirst. Over the past few years, I've been on a journey of enlightenment, a journey to better myself, mind, body, and soul. My journey started with a calling from God. I needed to get closer to Him if I really wanted to be a better version of myself. What I found is, as I sought to understand His word better, to listen to His still, small voice, I've become stronger. Stronger in many areas, but specifically in my faith, which feeds into other areas of my life. With this strength and better understanding, I find that scripture, it just hits differently. Specifically during this Lenten season, as we follow Jesus on His journey to the cross, death, and glorious resurrection, I felt His pain that demands you not to rely on your own understanding, but instead trust in the Lord, to not seek comfort in the things of the world, but seek comfort in the Lord God. There are several instances where Jesus mentions thirst. John 4:13-14, everyone who drinks this water will be thirsty again, but whoever drinks the water I give them will never thirst. John 7:37-38, in the last day, that great day of the feast, Jesus stood and cried, saying, if any man thirst, let him come unto me and drink. In his final moments on the cross, the thirst which Jesus felt within him was no mere dehydration. No vinegar, nor wine, nor water would be able to quench this thirst. The thirst he felt could only be quenched by the salvation that comes from God, a message that he had been sharing even in his last moments. In our own lives, we all have this thirst. In my own life, I know there are areas where I am lacking or need support or simply just need more of the Lord's favor and grace, gaps that need to be filled. As a mother, I seek to set the very best example for my daughter and teach her about the saving power of the Lord. At work, I want to be the very best at my job. I want to stand out and I want to make moves and excel. In my finances, well, we all want financial freedom and the ability to give my family all that they need. And in my personal life, I want to be a better version of me, a God-fearing woman who lives her life as a testimony to God's grace. I want to walk with God and be a better child of God. There are so many areas in my life where I thirst, and I'm so truly blessed, without a doubt, but still, I thirst. I thirst for God in every aspect of my life. I thirst for the blood of Jesus to save and cover me. I thirst for the salvation that can only come from God. I thirst as Jesus thirsts, for God to save him and accept him into his kingdom of love and light. Throughout this season, I've really tried to take time to build my relationship to God, to talk to him and listen to him more. My relationship with God is the most important relationship I have. It sets the tone for every other relationship. The more I live seeking to be filled by the Holy Spirit, the more I will long for God and further revelation of God's character. Only he can quench my thirst, because only God truly knows my heart. Psalm 42:1-2 says, As the deer pants for the water brooks, my soul pants for you, O my God. My soul thirsts for you, for the living God. Amen.
The sixth word, it is finished. From reading the four Gospels, it is startling how often Jesus could have avoided the cross. Before his arrest and conviction, Jesus had told his disciples, "I lay down my life only to take it up again. No one takes it up again, but I lay it down of my own accord." His death was no suicide or martyrdom. His death was so meaningful that he chose to accept it. On the eve of his crucifixion, Jesus prayed, "I have brought you glory on earth by completing the work you gave me to do." Jesus turned away from easy and popular leadership, and even though he could have been delivered from the reach of enemies, consistently he refused to exercise miraculous powers to win people to himself. In his last hours, Jesus could have saved himself from the faltering temple guards. He stopped Peter's sword swinging and said, "Do you think I cannot call on my Father and he would at once put at my disposal more than 12 legions of angels?" At his request, angelic hosts and their chariots of fire that guarded Elisha and his frightened servant would have instantly responded in full battle regalia. They bounded the hands of Jesus in the garden where he laid. They led him through the streets in shame. They spat upon the Savior, so pure and free from sin. They said, "Crucify him, he is to be blamed." To the howling mob, he yielded. He did not for mercy cry. The cross of shame he took alone, and when he cried out, "It is finished," he gave himself to die. Salvation's wondrous plan was done. He could have called 10,000 angels to destroy the world and set him free. Yes, my friends, he could have called 10,000 angels. But what did he do? He died alone for you and for me. It is finished. Amen.
The story speaks of finality after the sixth word and its finish. And it also speaks about surrender and trust. After the torture and suffering that Jesus endured on the cross, he said these words, "Father, into thy hand I commit my spirit." That's the Psalms version. Our Father, into thy hands I commend my spirit, the Luke's virgin. These words were spoken when Jesus realized that his earthly life was coming to an end. The word commit and commend means to place in or entrust. Jesus places his spirit or entrust it into God's hands because he knew that his spirit was safe in God's hands. He was exchanging a crown of thorns for a crown of glory. Just imagine that you have a terminal illness and very close to death. You'll be fearful and you'll be in distress. I imagine that Jesus had those same feelings. Through his 7 sins from the cross, he went through many emotions: surrender, distress, humiliation, abandonment, and trust. It also talks of Jesus' reunion with the Father, for he knew that this was the end he must come to before he rose on the 3rd day, a promise he made to his disciples. The story of the prodigal son was the last parable that Jesus spoke before his death. Some writers suggest that he uses this parable to show the trust between him and his father. When the prodigal son was at his lowest, even though he had betrayed his father, the father was there to love and to care for him and to protect him. Just like a child who is lost and afraid, it looks for its mother because they know that it's safety and trust in its mother's arms. When Jesus was in most pain, he ran to his father because he knew there was safety and security. The words hands bears a lot of importance here because they used their hands to pierce him and to strike him, but he felt secure in God's hands. My brothers and sisters in Christ, I ask us to live our lives worthy of the sacrifice that was made on our behalf when Jesus died on the cross. Amen.
I'd like to thank those who shared the reflections today. Thank you for your faith. Thank you for your openness today. It was wonderful to hear your reflections on these very important words for this most holy day. I invite you to please rise if you are able. We will now sing, "There's a Green Hill Far Away."
Thank you.
I invite you to please be seated as Mac, Hazel, and Judith chant us through the solemn intercessions.
Almighty and everlasting God, by your Spirit, the whole body of your faithful people is governed and sanctified. Receive our supplications and prayers which we offer before you for all members of your holy church, that in our vocation and ministry we may truly and devoutly serve you through our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Let us pray for all nations and peoples of the earth, and for those in authority among them, for Charles our King and all the royal family, for Justin the Prime Minister, and for the government of this country, for Doug, the Premier of this province, and the members of the legislature, for the mayor of this municipality, and those who serve with them, on the city council, for all who serve the common good, that by God's help, they may seek justice and truth, and live in peace and concord.
Almighty God, kindle, we pray, in every heart the true love of Jesus, and guide with your wisdom those who take counsel for the nations of the earth, that justice and peace may increase until the earth is filled with the knowledge of your love, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Let us pray for all who suffer and are afflicted in body or mind, for the hungry and homeless, the destitute and the oppressed, and all who suffer persecution or prejudice, for the sick, the wounded, and the handicapped, for those in loneliness, fear, and anguish, for those who face temptation, doubt, and despair, for the sorrowful and bereaved, for prisoners and captives, for those in mortal danger, that God in his mercy will comfort and relieve them and grant them the knowledge of his love and stir up in us the will and patience to minister to their needs.
Gracious God, the comfort of all who sorrow, the strength of all who suffer, hear the cry of those in misery and need.
In their affliction, show them your mercy, and give us, we pray, the strength to serve them. For the sake of him who suffered for us, your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray for all who have not received the gospel of Christ, for all who have not heard the words of salvation, for all who have lost their faith, for all whose sin have made them indifferent to Christ, for all who are enemies of the cross of Christ and persecutors of his disciples, for all who in the name of Christ have persecuted others, that God will open their hearts to the truth and lead them to faith and obedience.
Merciful God, creator of the peoples of the earth and lover of souls, have compassion on all who do not know you as you are revealed in your Son, Jesus Christ. Let your gospel be preached with grace and power to those who have not heard it. Turn the hearts of those who resist it and bring hope to your fold those who have gone astray, that there may be one flock under one shepherd, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Let us commit ourselves to God and pray for the grace of a holy life, that with all who have departed this life and have died in the peace of Christ, and those whose faith is known to God alone, we may be accounted worthy to enter into the fullness of the joy of our Lord and receive the crown of life in the day of resurrection.
God of unchangeable power and eternal light, look favorably on your whole church, that wonderful and sacred mystery. By the effectual working of your providence, carry out in tranquility the plan of salvation. Let the whole world see and know that things which were cast down are being raised up, and things which had grown old are being made new, and that all things are being brought to their perfection by him through whom all things were made, your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
I was free.
I'm free from the fear of tomorrow. I'm free from the guilt of my past. Oh, I've traded my shackles for a glorious song. I'm free, praise the Lord, free at last.
I am free from the guilt that I carry, from the dull, empty life I'm set free. For when I met Jesus, he made me complete. He forgot the foolish one I used to be.
I'm free from the fear of tomorrow. I'm free from the guilt of my past. For I've traded my shackles for a glorious song. I'm free, praise the Lord, free at last. For I've traded my shackles for a glorious song. I'm free, praise the Lord, free at last.
Thank you so much, Hazel and Judith and Mac, for the solemn intercessions and for that wonderful duet. At this time, Mac and I will be bringing forward the cross and unveiling the cross that will be used for our meditation. This is the wood of the cross on which hung the Savior of the world. This is the wood of the cross on which hung the Savior of the world. This is the wood of the cross on which hung the Savior of the world.
Amen.
Christ our Lord became obedient unto death.
Amen.
The anthems for today will now be said. I invite you to join in the response indicated on the screen. Is it nothing to you, all you who pass by? Look and see if there is any sorrow like my sorrow, which was brought upon me, which the Lord inflicted on the day of his fierce anger.
Holy God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal one, have mercy upon us.
O my people, O my church, what have I done to you? Or in what have I offended you? Testify against me. I led you forth from the land of Egypt and delivered you by the waters of baptism, but you have prepared a cross for your Savior.
Holy God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal one, have mercy upon us.
I led you through the desert 40 years and fed you with manna. I brought you through tribulation and penitence and gave you my body, the bread of heaven, but you have prepared a cross for your Savior.
Holy God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal one,
have mercy upon us. What more could I have done for you that I have not done? I planted you my chosen and fairest vineyard. I made you the branches of my vine. But when I was thirsty, you gave me vinegar to drink and pierced with a spear the side of your Savior.
Holy God, holy and immortal one,
mercy upon us. I went before you in a pillar of cloud, and you have led me to the judgment hall of Pilate. I scourged your enemies and brought you to a land of freedom, but you have scourged, mocked, and beaten me. I gave you the water of salvation from the rock, but you have given me gall and left me to thirst.
Holy God, holy and immortal one,
have mercy upon us. I gave you a royal scepter and bestowed the keys to the kingdom, but you have given me a crown of thorns. I raised you on high with great power, but you have hanged me on the cross.
Holy God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal one,
have mercy upon us. My peace I gave, which the world cannot give, and washed your feet as a sign of my love. But you draw the sword to strike in my name and seek high places in my kingdom. I offered you my body and blood, but you scatter and deny and abandon me.
Holy God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal one,
have mercy upon us. I sent the Spirit of truth to guide you, and you close your hearts to the Counselor. I pray that all may be as one in the Father and me, but you continue to quarrel and divide. I call you to go and bring forth fruit, but you cast lots for my clothing.
Holy God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal one,
have mercy upon us. I grafted you into the tree of my chosen Israel, and you turned on them with persecution and mass murder. I made you joint heirs with them of my covenants, but you made them scapegoats for your own guilt.
Holy God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal one,
have mercy upon us. I came to you as the least of your brothers and sisters. I was hungry and you gave me no food. I was thirsty and you gave me no drink. I was a stranger and you did not welcome me, naked and you did not clothe me, sick and in prison and you did not visit me.
Holy God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal one,
have mercy upon us. We glory in your cross, O Lord, and praise and glorify your holy resurrection. For by virtue of your cross, joy has come to the whole world. May God be merciful to us and bless us. Show us the light of his countenance and come to us. Let your ways be known upon the earth, your saving health among all nations. Let the peoples praise you, O God. Let all the peoples praise you. Glory in your cross, O Lord, and praise and glorify your holy resurrection. For by virtue of your cross, joy has come to the whole world. Together, we adore you, O Christ, and we bless you, because by your holy cross you have redeemed the world. If we have died with him, we shall also live with him. If we endure, we shall also reign with him.
We adore you, O Christ, and we bless you, because by your holy cross you have redeemed the world.
O Savior of the world, by your cross and precious blood you have redeemed us.
Save us and help us, we humbly beseech you, O Lord.
We now come to the meditation on the cross. As in previous years, we ask that if you wish to come forward to meditate on the cross and venerate, that you form up a line down the center aisle. Once again, we do not have the kneelers, so please stand. You may touch the cross. You may spend as much time as you need to in the front. We have placed it closer to the step this year, so whoever is at the front of the line and at the cross can be right beside it. And the next person, please stop at the front row to give a little bit of space for privacy. But we have room now for after you venerate, you can make your way down the side aisle and back to your seat. During this time, we will have hymns playing. Please feel free to either pray or to sing along with those hymns.
Watching for you and for me. Unlisted.